to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Will the clerk call roll, please?
Counselor Boland?
Here.
Counselor Elliott?
Here.
Counselor Fisher?
Here.
Counselor Furlow?
Here.
Counselor Grizzle?
Here.
And Counselor Rieskamp?
Here.
Thank you. And next up is the oath of office for the newly elected officials. If the newly elected officials will come up to the front, we will have our swearing in. Okay, next up is the election of the council president. Do I have any nominations?
I nominate Bob Elliott, Councillor Elliott.
Second. First, is there any other nominations?
Oh.
That's okay. Okay, seeing none?
Second.
Second on the nomination? All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? Our new council president. Welcome, Bob.
Thank you. Another 2 years.
And next up, we have the approval of the council minutes from December 14th, 2016 regular session minutes.
Move for approval.
Second.
Been moved and seconded to approve the minutes. All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? Minutes have passed. Tonight's consent calendar, Lebanon City Council agenda for tonight, January 11th. Local Marijuana Tax Collection, IGA Revision, Airport Road, Russell Drive Improvement Project, and the Jennings Street and William Street ROW Vacation.
I move for approval.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the consent calendar. All those in favor say aye.
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 Those against?
Mr. Mayor, I just want to make sure that you understood that there's an addition to the consent calendar.
I missed that on my copy.
For Conversion Brewery.
Oh, I have that, but I didn't have it written on here. And there also, did you guys get a copy of the Conversion Brewery letter?
Yes.
Yes, we did. Yes.
Okay. And that then is also on the consent calendar, which I did not read off. Okay.
Do we need to move to approve the consent calendar as amended? Yes.
I think on the consent calendar, we can do it as amended.
The agenda should be amended. You're right. You're correct. I move to approve the consent calendar as amended.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? Thank you, Councilor Prism. And public comments. At this time, we have an opportunity for citizens to comment on items discussed at the earlier work session. We didn't have that tonight. Or any other city business. This council welcomes all respectful comments regarding the city's business. Citizens may address the council by approaching the microphone, signing in, and stating their name and address for the record. Each citizen is provided up to 5 minutes to provide the comments to the council. The council may take an additional 2 minutes to respond. The city clerk will accept and distribute written comments at a speaker's request. Were there anybody signed up?
No.
Okay. Is there anybody that would like to speak to council? Okay. Seeing none, we'll move into the main part of the meeting. We will continue the public hearing from last month that was adjourned, and that's number one, the Cheetah Lake Urban Renewal Amendment, and that will be presented by Walt Wendelowski and consultant Elaine Howard.
Good evening, good evening, Mayor, members of the City Council. Congratulations, everyone.
Thank you.
Okay. The staff came before you in October requesting amendments to the Cheetah Lake URD. As the Urban Renewal Agency, you concurred with the recommendation, directed staff to proceed with the necessary steps. This included coordination with affected agencies, and a hearing before the Planning Commission. The proposed amendments are now returning to the Council for final adoption. For the record, the Planning Commission reviewed the amendments, determined they conform to the City's comprehensive plan. As earlier noted, there are three basic changes here. We're looking at a boundary adjustment to add about 47 acres of industrial land. There's also a modified project list that, again, the Commission determined is consistent with our strategic plan and also master plans. And finally, there is an extension of the time period. Tonight, tonight Elaine Howard will be making the formal presentation with regard to these amendments, and I'll be here to answer any particular planning questions you may have or actions by the Planning Commission. And with that, I will introduce Elaine Howard, and she will proceed.
Hi. Unfortunately, the hearing was held over last time because I was unable to make it because they had a snowstorm in Portland. And I spent 2.5 hours trying to get on the freeway in Portland to get here and then called and said, well, it's not going to happen. So, of course, this morning I woke up and I had 15 inches of snow in my front yard. So I determined I would get here no matter what and left Portland at 1 o'clock today to make sure I would be here for you tonight.
Thank you.
Happy to be here. I've worked with Lebanon for a long time and enjoy working with you and am pleased to help present this amendment. The purpose of the amendment is to implement the Russell Drive Area Mixed-Use Neighborhood Plan, implementation plan. This amendment allows the urban renewal area to go longer than it originally was set to, and we'll cover that as we move forward in the presentation. Because this was advertised as a public hearing, you have to notify all citizens in the city of an amendment, a substantial amendment to an urban renewal plan. I'm going to cover just a little bit about how urban renewal works and how the financing works. So when an urban renewal area is designated, the tax assessed values of all of the properties within that area is calculated by the county assessor. And the assessor creates what's called a frozen base of assessed value within that area. That doesn't mean that taxes don't go up in the area. It just means that taxes off of that frozen base continue going to all of the different taxing jurisdictions. But any increase in value above that frozen base, the taxes off of that increased value go to the Urban Renewal Agency to do projects and programs within the urban renewal area. The tax bills that go to citizens of Lebanon show urban renewal on them. Every property owner has urban renewal on their tax bill, whether or not they're within an urban renewal area. And that is because the way the property tax system works, a portion of their taxes are divided out to pay to the urban renewal agency for each urban renewal area. That doesn't mean that their taxes increase. It means that a portion of those taxes go to the urban renewal area that otherwise would have gone to the different taxing jurisdictions. This is showed in concept in this graph. You can see across the bottom it says frozen base, so that would be what the potential assessed value is of an urban renewal area at the time it's established. And then that value goes up by state law. The county assessor may increase the property tax up to 3% if your value increases. So what that graph shows is at the beginning of an urban renewal area, if there are 3% increases in property values, the taxes off of that, where it says increment, goes to the urban renewal agency. If there are new projects that occur within the new urban renewal area, new development, the taxes off of that entire new development go to the urban renewal agency to do projects and programs in the area. And that goes for the length of the urban renewal area, and at the time that the urban renewal area expires, then all of those taxes off of that value, the increased value within the area and the frozen base, go to all the taxing jurisdictions. So it's just during the time of urban renewal that that portion of taxes gets divided out to the urban renewal agency for the area. There are state limitations on urban renewal. For a city with a population under 50,000, which Lebanon is, you may have up to 25% of your total assessed value in urban renewal, and you may have up to 25% of your total acreage in urban renewal. There are also limitations on existing urban renewal plans. You may not increase your urban renewal plan by more than 20% of the original acreage. And that we had to look at for this amendment because we're adding quite a bit of acreage. And the maximum indebtedness of an urban renewal area may not be increased by more than 20% of the original maximum indebtedness. In this case, the maximum indebtedness is not being proposed to be increased, but that's just to let you know that that is a limitation by statute. So in Lebanon, you use urban renewal well. You have three existing urban renewal areas, and you have 23.17% of your total acreage in urban renewal. Remember I said you can have up to 25%. The other urban renewal areas, especially for those of you who just took office, you may or may not know, the Northwest Lebanon urban renewal area is where the Lowe's Distribution Center is, and the North Gateway urban renewal area is the home of the medical school, and all of that new development that has occurred in that section of your city is in an urban renewal area and was really spurred by the ability to put that infrastructure in using the tool of urban renewal. So you are under those statutory limitations. Your assessed value that's in urban renewal at this point is under 5%, so it's well beneath the limitation, but you do have constraints there. If you want to add new urban renewal areas in the future, you are very close to your limitation. Substantial amendments are defined by the Oregon statute, and a substantial amendment is any time you add property to an urban renewal area in excess of 1% of your original acreage of the area. This is a substantial amendment because of that. You are adding property over that 1%. Also, in your original urban renewal plan, there was a duration provision in that urban renewal plan, which meant that your urban renewal area expired at a specific date. That's not required in urban renewal plans, but this particular one did have that, and the expiration date was in August of 2018. In the plan, it said that removing that duration was a substantial amendment, so that is also part of why this is called a substantial amendment. In doing this amendment, we also worked with your city staff to revise your project priorities, and we'll have those, and those are in those documents that you received. And we did general updates to the plan to bring it up to current standards. You had new comprehensive plan information, so we updated all of that information also. A substantial amendment has to be adopted in the same way that an original urban renewal plan is adopted, which includes having your urban renewal agency review it, which you did in October, I believe, having it go to your planning commission. And then in this case, your county commission also has to approve the amendment. This is because of two things. It states it in your urban renewal plan, but the reason is there is property within this urban renewal area that is not incorporated in the city of Lebanon. And so the statute says whenever there's unincorporated property in an urban renewal area, the county also has to both approve the plan and approve any substantial amendment to the plan. So this is the map of the urban renewal area, the existing area, and it shows in the darker color the property that's being added to the urban renewal area. And again, as Mr. Wendelowski said, it's about 47 acres. It's 5 tax lots, and it's 18.9% of the original area, so under that 20% guideline. The maximum indebtedness of this urban renewal plan is $18,252,144. Maximum indebtedness is the total amount of money that you can spend in an urban renewal area on projects, programs, and administration. The original termination date was August 30th of 2018. When staff was reviewing this with us, we looked at that date, and it's very clear that you cannot reach your maximum indebtedness by that date. In fact, you have remaining about $15.7 million of maximum indebtedness. So what's happened in this urban renewal area is you had projections originally about the amount of money that this area would raise, and you've been unable to meet those projections because new development or substantial rehabilitation hasn't occurred within that urban renewal area. In the revisions that we've made, we removed that duration provision totally, but we've made projections about when it can reach its maximum indebtedness, and those projections say that that would be in fiscal year end 2036. So again, that's not a hard date on your urban renewal plan. The hard date is when you reach that $18,252,000 worth of maximum indebtedness. The way the Oregon Revised Statute is written now, that maximum indebtedness is a statutory constraint on urban renewal, so you don't also have to have a duration provision. Again, Linn County approval is required because of the changing of the duration provision and because of the unincorporated properties. Are there any questions on that before I go forward? So this is the new project list that's in your documents, and so the phase one and phase two projects are projects that are anticipated that could be funded within that time frame. And you can see in that final column when the expected completion date is of those projects. So some of those projects are hoped to happen this year. The Porter Park is a fiscal year 2017 project. The Russell Drive project and the airport road projects are also 2017. And then other projects have to wait until there is sufficient funding to do those projects. So if you have questions about that project list, city staff is here and would be quite happy to answer any of that. They're in your documents. There's three phases of projects. So these are the first two, and it is anticipated that these projects could be funded. This is the third phase of projects, and we left those in the plan. But right now, there is not sufficient funding to do those projects. If you were able to get grants or under other funding sources or were able to use other city funds to do some of the other projects, then you still could address some of these other projects and add funding to them. But the way the plan is designed at this point with the expectations, we don't have enough money to do these projects. We left them in hoping that we could figure out a way in the future to make that happen, but at this point they aren't. Again, the updates to the plan and report, we added in the Porter Park project and we added in the water treatment plant. We updated all of the zoning to conform to current development code, and we updated the relationship to the local objective section for conformance to your comprehensive plan. The way urban renewal works, there are impacts to taxing jurisdictions. So the city of Lebanon is one of those taxing jurisdictions, as well as the county, the fire district. So there are direct impacts to those taxing jurisdictions as a result of urban renewal. The way Schools are funded right now. School districts and the Education Service District are not directly impacted by urban renewal because they are funded through the state school fund on a per pupil allocation. So their urban renewal any place in the state of Oregon impacts the amount of money that goes to that fund for the state school fund. And the legislature, they'll be wrestling with that this year, as they always do, about what funding sources go into that state school fund to get that per pupil allocation. This just shows, and in your document, it shows a projected annual impact to all of those different taxing jurisdictions. This shows what that total impact would be to be able to reach the rest of that maximum indebtedness. So you can see for the city of Lebanon, it's $4.5 million of funds over the years to 2036 that you would not be receiving because the Urban Renewal Agency is receiving those funds. The process for the adoption of an Urban Renewal Plan substantial amendment is you need to send a formal notice to the taxing jurisdictions. That was sent on October 13th. You have to notify all property owners. That was done in utility bills in November. The Planning Commission reviewed this on November 16th and found that it was in conformance to the comprehensive plan. Linn County has to review this, as we said, and they are scheduled next Wednesday to review it. They wanted to wait until after the City Council voted their approval, if you do. So they have it on their agenda for next Wednesday. So tonight is your opportunity to review it, ask questions, and vote as you wish on the ordinance. Any questions? Yes.
Have there been any comments from the taxing districts that notices were sent to?
No, sir.
Other questions?
Okay. Is that it from staff? Or is there more? Okay. And with that, we will close the... I'm sorry. At this point, we'll have proponents' testimony. If there's anyone in the audience that's here to speak in favor of this proposal on the URD, you can come up and speak. If there's anyone against this URD amendment and change, hello.
I'm Dr. Misty McDowell, and I'm at 2090 Mill Street in Lebanon. I don't know if I'm necessarily directly opposed, but I do have some concerns about it that I wanted to raise. So my primary concern is a big part of this is the Russell Drive extension. And previously, my gosh, I'm 36, so for the past 20 years, it feels like this Russell Drive extension has come up over and over and over. And every time it's found to not be feasible. When they're wanting to extend it onto an old mill site that was literally a pond that has then been filled in with sawdust and toilets and all sorts of extraneous fill, every time it goes to a point and it gets evaluated by engineers, they look at it and they go, whoa, this can't be done. If we put this road in, it'll look pretty, but it's going to turn into a disaster. And so that's what's come up in the past every time. And I want to make sure that's brought up again because it's just, it's never worked out. It's been something that's been addressed so many times, I'm kind of sick of it, having lived there my whole life. And so it's really unsettling that it's coming up yet again. And the closest that it ever came to being feasible previously was the road had to be very, very carefully located in a very small zone of some stable soil that was there. And it couldn't curve around as they're wanting to do at this point. It had to go straight through where the railroad is, and a new railroad crossing had to be put in. And every time that came up, then everybody would screech and halt because, of course, there's a lot of expense and issues that go with that as far as private property in the way and all sorts of things. So, yeah, I'm very concerned about that.
Okay.
So I don't know. I'm going to go ahead. I spoke with Mr. Wendelowski, and I'm also going to speak with Mr. Woodlatch about that, but I just want to make sure that that's heard. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Ron, Latch, would you come up to the mic? Ron is our engineering services director. I could speak to this, but Ron can speak to it with more expertise than I. The proposed road has been engineered to all the standard specifications that are necessary, and it is indeed stable. But, Ron, I'd like you to comment on that.
Well, I'm not sure, for one, exactly where you're talking about. Are you talking about the airport road extension? So out across through the property that we purchased?
Yes.
Okay. That's the first that we've heard of it. We've done geotech work out there. It seems to be fairly stable, so I'm not sure. You know, there is an old wigwam burner out there that, you know, that we'll have to dig out, obviously. But short of that, I see no issue. We've done geotech work and had holes dug, and I think we're fine. I don't see any issue with constructing the road out there.
No toilets? So did you say there's toilets?
Oh, my goodness. You would not believe the things. Like when they dug the I guess it's a ditch that drains the wetlands through there.
Coming to dumpy ground?
Yeah.
That's not to say that you won't find stuff like that.
I mean, that's... But it was, you know, it was a mill pond that floated logs forever. So,
those are very valid concerns.
Slowly filled it in. And so I just don't want anybody to end up in a mess. Because, like I said, in the past, that's always what we've run into. So...
Sure. No, and we look at all that stuff, and we've got contingencies built in for over excavation in areas that we need to over excavate. But again, we've dug holes out there, done infiltration tests, done the geotech work, and you know, we haven't found anything that we haven't found anywhere else. So yet, so that's not to say that we won't. But yeah, at this point, I think we're safe and moving forward. Okay.
Sounds good.
Right. Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you.
Thanks, Ron. Is there anyone else who would like to speak against this? A time for applicant rebuttal. I guess that would be the city in this case. Wouldn't have any of that. Now, at this point, we'll close the public testimony. All further discussion will be limited to the council and city staff. Is there any council discussion, other questions or concerns?
I'd just like to ask... Gary or our budget staff, if they're here tonight, what impact we think that not having that $4.5 million is going to do to the city in the light of PERS issues and other kinds of things that are going to be coming down the pike.
Interesting question. Thank you. The money that's projected that we don't receive is also money projected on revenue or value that doesn't necessarily exist right now and won't exist unless it's in it's incentivized and brought about by the capital improvements and the infrastructure that are put on that then bring that value to bear or bring it to reality.
Okay.
So to say it's money that we're doing without is kind of a misnomer because it's money that we would never have if we didn't employ the urban renewal tool to bring new growth to the area, and that's the whole point of it. So by the time we're done, hopefully we have added that value to the tax base, and so then all of that value is then released to the city and other overlapping tax jurisdictions, and then we do indeed begin receiving that money. But the whole point of urban renewal is to bring that value about. So
right. So the bottom line is, and what I was hoping that you'd say, is that the $15 million out there does not exist today.
And not all of it. Some of it has grown over time. There's a little bit of it there. But again, it didn't exist when we started, and that was the point of this exercise.
And the development would have to occur in order for that full $15 million to be realized.
Yes, that's what this whole structure is built on, yes.
What were the initial terms that you are doing? What was the initial lifespan of it?
Well, that predates me quite a bit, but I believe the URD was first put together in early 2000s. I think it was either 2001, 2002, and it was projected to go to 2018. What happened was, and Elaine spoke to that briefly, that the value didn't grow as projected. I will contend to some extent that it didn't grow because some of the capital improvements that were in the plan weren't employed, but it was kind of like which happens first, you know, the improvement or the value. So it didn't perform as we had intended, and then we had the what some people have called the Great Recession. And so just nothing happened during most of the period for that urban renewal district. Now we've gotten to the point where we've seen recovery in our local economy. Some property values are coming back and growing, and we're seeing the light at the end of the tunnel. However, the end of the tunnel is just on us next year, because this urban renewal district will expire and go away if we don't amend it and then be able to use it as we originally intended, however updated to make sense for projects that need to be done today. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I was just a little shocked at the extent of the extension. The 18 years of extension was shocking to me. And I know there are other agencies that are waiting for expiration. And so that extended period of time, and I understand that reaching the maximum indebtedness could come sooner, but.
Yeah. Kind of off the point, but probably some good news in the near future is one of our other URDs is reaching a point where most of the projects will be done, and we will at some point in the near future not have to levy 100% of that district, which means a substantial portion of those funds, I'm talking about North Gateway, will begin to come back to the overlapping districts. So there is some benefit coming back to overlapping districts and the city very soon, but not from this district.
Was that your concern about the revenue returning to the overlapping districts, or making it available to other projects?
The revenue that is not being distributed to other districts, special districts. You can guess why. But.
Well, yeah, and that's the reason. That's
obligated.
The reason
I'm concerned.
Had any of the taxing districts filed a comment about it?
No, I think. I mean, you could file a comment. But
I did have a discussion with Chief Sletmo with the fire district, and we had a good exchange on that. I think Gordon is supportive of course, the whole community effort to improve itself, and we have some ongoing discussions with him about possible ways that we can, like I was just mentioning, lighten the load in other areas of our URD mechanisms. So
the viewpoint from the other districts, especially service districts such as the fire district, is that the development occurs, the infrastructure goes in, and we're required to provide service without recouping tax revenue to offset that. So it's as if you're expanding your service area, but you're not getting any revenue to help fill that expansion. So
Wayne, did you have a question?
Kind of a follow-up to Councillor Boland's. What was the primary, I guess, information that caused it to go out to 18 years further, to 36? Is that a standard length of time? Or
I'd like to have Elaine come up and respond to that.
Probably the estimated time of the value that for it to increase, yeah. I would guess.
I could explain it, but I know Elaine's going to do a better job.
In the report that accompanies the urban renewal plan, Nick Popanek from Tiberius Solutions works with me as a co-consultant on all of my urban renewal work. And in this, there is a table that, a number of tables that kind of start on page 28.
Right.
And they make financial projections for the urban renewal area, assuming growth amounts within the area, and that 2036 was arrived at by saying, if we have X amount of growth within the area, how long will it take us to get to that amount of maximum indebtedness? So it's not an arbitrary number at all. It's a number that's derived by using what the total assessed value is now and using assumptions based on growth that we went over with city staff. And it's actually fairly aggressive growth. We're saying 6% growth within that area instead of 3%. So that means there has to be new development or substantial rehabilitation that occurs within that area to be able to reach that 2036 timeframe. So it's based on looking at what the reality is there and what growth could cause to get you to that maximum indebtedness number. And as long as I'm here, let me talk a little bit about why it didn't reach that before. So if you're, it's very real to the other taxing districts and to the city that they lose a portion of that money. The reality is when this plan was adopted, they anticipated or they were told that what the maximum indebtedness is. Only $3 million of that has been used, where they thought by August of 2018 the full $18 million would be used. So the impact so far on all those taxing districts has been very tiny from this urban renewal area. That doesn't mean they aren't real. They're just much lower than what they would have been if that district had been able to reach its expectations. So by not increasing the maximum indebtedness, it is having a continued life of impacts on those taxing districts, but the overall dollar amount isn't changing. It's the same dollar amount that they talked about when it was originally adopted. It's just taken longer to accumulate that dollar amount, and so the impact to the taxing districts is spread over a longer period, but it's much lower, if that makes sense.
So in essence, the growth has not occurred in that area. Therefore, potentially, there's not been the...
Right.
But the tax revenue continues to rise at 3%, and that's what...
And that's what
stops.
But even in the recession, that tax revenue didn't rise 3%, right? It didn't go up, and a lot of times it went down. So that recession hurt most urban renewal areas within the city. And in this particular urban renewal area, when you look at it, there's not a lot of new development that's happened there. There's a lot of existing kind of lower assessed value development within the area, so that 3% growth on that development is pretty small. It's real.
It's real. It's definitely the lightest of the three URBs,
right.
But
right.
It's not the one we're watching to fall off, that's for sure.
Right.
Any other questions?
I just wanted to clarify, too, that it was this district that enabled the infrastructure to go down to McKinney Lane for the new apartments to be built, correct?
That is correct.
Yes.
Thank you, Lane. Okay, with no other questions, we'll have the city attorney read the ordinance.
Ordinance bill number 2017-1, ordinance number 2889. A bill making certain determinations and findings relating to and approving the Cheetah Lake Urban Renewal Amendment.
Call for a motion. Approval.
Second it.
It's been moved and seconded to approve Ordinance Bill 2017-1. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The ordinance passes. And the public hearing is now closed, and we'll move back into our regular session. Number two, Republic Service Rates Amendments. Gary Marks and Julie Jackson.
I'll defer to Julie Jackson to report to the council on their proposed change to their rate schedule.
Great. Thank you for giving me some time tonight. I will try to be really quick as it looks like you have a full agenda. So I think you have in front of you a schedule of proposed rate amendments. Is that correct? Mm-hmm. So probably the biggest piece of information I need to give you about these is that they are not rate increases for anyone. They are new rates that are not on the rate sheet. So when we notice that something needs to be on a rate sheet, we come to you and we ask if that's okay with you to do that. And so that's what these are. I can go rate by rate and tell you what they are, or I can answer questions, whatever you'd like. But there is one that I want to point out to you, and that's the very first one. It's cart delivery or re-delivery. And I want to explain the reasoning behind that one, because that's the one that probably a lot of these rates nobody's ever going to be charged, and very few of your customers. This is also one that people have a choice, except for new customers. So when a new customer sets up service, we have a separate truck that brings carts out to their residence, and that would be charged at that time, a one-time situation, and most people would never ever be charged that again. But there is a situation that has become pretty problematic for us, and that is a situation where folks don't pay their bill. It takes about 90 days before they get letters, they get phone calls, they get all kinds of information about, you know, give us a call, let us know if we can help you, those kinds of things. But after about 90 days, we do go out and attempt to pick up carts. Sometimes we can pick them up, sometimes they're hidden, just depends on the situation. But we do go out and attempt to pick up carts. And at that point, then what typically happens is folks will realize they don't have a garbage cart, they'll call and pay their bill, and then we have to wash carts and take carts right back out. So that's the reasoning behind that one. And I you know, that is the one that I think could cause some heartburn. We've adopted this in almost every other city in the valley that we work in, and I think it's fair. Sometimes we go out 5 and 6 times trying to find carts and take those carts. I will tell you that if we can't recover carts, we charge a $75 cart fee. But the minute they pay their bill and ask to have their service restarted, we credit that fee back. We never charge that to anyone unless we really can't get a cart. And, of course, if someone leaves town and they're charged that, we rarely see that. It might stay on their bill, but we rarely see that money. So that's really the reasoning behind that one. And then a lot of others are just, we used to have a lot of furniture. We had a couch rate and a chair rate and a table rate and all kinds of rates, and we've just averaged those all together. They were all pretty close together, and we're just trying to simplify, kind of speak the language, same language across all the divisions we work in.
What is the dead large animal? I just got to know.
You would have liked that better, where the way I first put it on there, and actually went to a city and it said dead large deer, D-E-A-R. That might have been Freudian, I don't know. We are asked often to pick up, if a deer has been hit, we've had a horse, we had a cow, but if there's a large animal in the public right of way and we're asked to come out and pick it up, that's the charge for that. And typically it's two drivers and sometimes a backhoe, and it's pretty messy.
Yeah.
What do you charge for?
It's who do we charge? We charge whomever has called us. So sometimes it can be the state will call. Sometimes it will be a jurisdiction. We've had homeowners call as well.
Yeah. So don't call if there's a deer in front of your house.
I know. Go in the house and shut the door.
Call animal control.
Yeah.
But you'd be amazed how many times we have picked up deer. Especially in Corvallis. It seems to happen there a lot. Students.
Any other questions?
About the commercial container replacement, $480, that's...
Remember that $75 I told you about for carts? That is, if you had a commercial container, a two-yard dumpster at your commercial location, and somehow you destroyed it, you dropped a boulder on it, you put it on a trailer and drove it off, something like that. This is one that I don't anticipate we would ever charge anyone. But I just had a call yesterday, in fact, and I had one about a month or 2 months ago from the Benton County District Attorney's Office, and they had a person who was doing restitution for some dumpsters he had set on fire. And so they needed a replacement cost for that, and that's why we put that one on. And so if you want to take that down the page a little bit, you'll see the container recovery for an industrial drop box is $4,000. Can't imagine ever charging that. But should someone back up and hook up and haul one off and it's gone, that would be the replacement cost for that.
And I just had one other question.
Sure.
In your letter, I assume in the second paragraph we're talking about 2017 and not 2107.
Great. I'm pretty good at transposing numbers. I appreciate you pointing that out.
Just say yes, dear.
Very good.
Yeah, and spelling dear wrong, apparently. Yeah.
Just to let you know, I read.
I love to come here. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you, Julie.
Sure. And so just because I have auditors and people who like us to dot all our I's and cross all our T's, what we really like to have, if you don't mind, is just formal approval of these amendments to go on the rate sheet, and then we're kind of legal.
Okay. Call for a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the Republic Services rate amendments. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? The motion passes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Julie.
Number three, approval of purchase property for future roadway Crowfoot Drive project. Ron Whitlatch.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, City Council. What we have before you here tonight is a proposal to purchase some right-of-way. Normally, we would do this on a consent calendar, but as you can see, it's a fairly good-sized piece of right-of-way, so I thought it probably warranted a little discussion. If you had questions, we could go over it. It's a piece of property at Crowfoot and Cascade Drive. The school district currently owns it. They came to us this last year with at first with a housing proposal for one of their programs at school. They determined that it probably wasn't very feasible based on the utilities that they would have to install, but they also knew that we were interested in it, along with Lane County, in order to improve the intersection there. You got five different streets coming together there. It's kind of a mess. So with that, they went to their board. They've offered to sell it for $80,000, which is roughly $40,000 an acre, which is fairly good price for that property, since it is developable. We really don't have any plans in the works right now to do anything with it. We'll look at it with Lynn County and us and hopefully do a joint project, look at different grants. We've applied for grants and haven't been successful yet, but maybe with this we can leverage it. But definitely want to have that option in the future. There's a couple of different options to realign it. We can realign it, taking the roads and bringing them in at right angles. We can talk about a roundabout. There's several different things that we can do there. But you asked the reason for 2.08 acres. One, we really don't know what we're going to end up doing there. It depends on what's warranted. So that's what we have before you. I'm more than willing to answer any questions you may have. And
where would the money come from for this?
Street SDCs.
Okay.
Do we have that much in that fund?
The street SDCs have roughly $2.5 million.
Okay.
Yeah. It's SDC eligible. It's kind of a weird deal. That whole area is SDC eligible for pedestrian improvements. But if you wrap, so it just means when we go to do the project, we won't be able to use SDCs as part of the construction of the project. We can use it for purchasing the property or however we want. It's just a certain percentage. So we looked at the percentage, and I don't remember what it is off the top of my head, but it fits well within that, what we'd be doing there.
So, Ron, I assume there's multiple designs that fit that space?
There is, yes.
And if we were to purchase the property and a design was chosen and it wasn't needed, then what?
A couple things we can do. You could try and sell it back to the school district, you know, buy high, sell low type thing.
$1,000 an acre.
To be honest with you, there's not going to be a whole lot of it left, even with the roundabout idea. The roundabout would be the one that would leave the most there. My gut tells me that in the time frame that this is going to get done, it probably will never meet the warrant of a roundabout. So it's going to be basically a decision that this body makes and says, no, we want a roundabout. From an engineering perspective, I'm not sure there's enough traffic generated at the intersection to warrant a roundabout. That's not to say that we can't do one. So most likely what you're going to end up with is swinging some of those roads out, especially like Central and those, and bringing them in at right angles to Cascade and to Crowfoot so that you meet all that. So there'll probably actually be additional right-of-way to buy. But I've worked with Darren Lane over in Lynn County, and they're going to purchase the other piece of right-of-way when it comes time for that, which it'll all tie in. And
on the east side?
Yeah, to be down there where I got my roads backed up, but where I believe Cascade continues and then Crowfoot goes out, there's a house there on the corner. There's another lot there that'll be needed in order to tie everything into 90 degrees. We've looked at several options there.
So all the streets then would be on a 90 degree.
That would be the goal, yeah. Yeah, because as it sits right now, it's really hard from a visual standpoint. It's not very good.
It's hard to look back.
But we could always put a roundabout there too. You know, they function well. It wouldn't warrant the traffic, but they're usable.
Can you tell us a little bit about the cost estimate, one versus the other?
We haven't even done a cost estimate, to be honest with you. The county's looked at several options to get Tiger grants there, and I never have seen their estimates. And one of them they used was a roundabout that we actually designed. We never did do a cost estimate on it, though. One versus the other, I couldn't tell you without doing some engineering on it and determining what we need to do there.
But we're nowhere near that decision.
No, I mean, unless something breaks loose, you know, development-wise, or we happen to get a grant, we have no mechanism to fund it. Or if Lynn County decides that they want to fund it all, you know, that's an option. But we'll at least have the right-of-way purchased. You know, it'll become ours. You ask why maybe Lynn County's not purchasing it. I mean, we'll have a little more control over what happens there if we have control of the right-of-way. When we take it over. So that was actually recommended by Darren as well, too.
So what would be the disadvantage if we didn't do this?
What would be the disadvantage? The school district's going to put it up for sale. Yeah, they want the property sold so they can continue on in their programs, their housing construction programs at the high school. This is one of the ways that they see to get dollars into their program out there. So that's why they're trying to sell it. They're trying to market it. They've just given us in Lynn County the first option to buy it. So if it does go to, let's say, somebody does decide to want to build houses there, which is a perfectly legitimate option to use the property for, you have lost your opportunity to ever realign that intersection. So it's not a must-have by any means. It's just an opportunity. We don't really like to go buy property that we don't have a defined short-term use for. But this is a future use that I see is probably a benefit to realigning that intersection, especially if some of the, you know, if you look at our city limits and our UGB, how it extends down there. Someday, there's going to be quite a few subdivisions down there. Someday. What someday? I don't know. But at that point, you're going to want that intersection realigned. It's going to come to that. So we don't want to have a development in the way that prevents that from happening, I guess, would be the benefit to doing it now.
Great.
But it's not anything that we have to have, per se, got to have this now. I mean, there's no project really set for it. So.
And this is in the urban growth boundary?
Yes. Yeah, just short of the city limits.
And one of the issues we have on the south side is that there's some bare land there for development at some point in time, which that improvement would...
That could be a giant intersection.
Giant interest.
Yes, or giant development down there. We've had several folks look at that in terms of subdivision.
Because we don't have a lot of acreage anywhere else. Thanks, Ron.
Yep.
Thanks, Ron. Any other questions? Okay, do I have a motion?
Move for the right-of-way designation.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the purchase of the Crowfoot Drive project. All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? Motion passes.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Ron. Number four, establishing marijuana licensing policy related to the results of Measure 22-147, Walt Wendelowski, presenting.
Thank you again, Mayor, members of the City Council. One other thing I forgot to add, Happy New Year to you all. Back in November, the voters of the city approved a ballot measure to allow the sale of recreational marijuana. The council directed staff to prepare the necessary municipal code amendments and to implement this decision. Originally, it was my intent, based on our conversation last month, I was going to incorporate it within the medical marijuana chapter within our code, which is 5.22. However, looking at it a little closer, I decided probably a little bit better to have its own separate chapter for the following reasons. One, we have separate state statutes on medical marijuana and recreational marijuana. Also, mixing the regulations might make it confusing to the public. In other words, it'd be a lot easier for city staff to say, if you're operating a medical facility, here's the rules, and if you're operating a recreational facility, here's the rules. And finally, we also anticipate that these rules at the state level will be changing and being modified over time, so it's a lot easier for the city to make their modifications as well. So with that, I created chapter 5.18. And you have a copy in your packet along with the adoption ordinance. What I'd like to do right now is briefly go through this material. There are eight sections under consideration here. First item is the purpose statement. This establishes the reasons behind this particular ordinance. And again, I think the important item is that we try to balance individual freedoms along with, you know, public health issues as well. Want to provide a little balance there. Second section is addressing definitions. These definitions are unique to this particular chapter and do not correspond to any of the definitions that are in chapter 5.22 on medical marijuana. The third section is relationship to other standards. It requires an operator to obtain the required licenses or permits from the state. Much like if you're opening a tavern or bar, you're required to get your OLCC license. Also, a note here that individuals or operators are not exempt from obtaining whatever building permits, land use approvals, or meeting fire code regulations as well. So they still must meet those. The fourth one is probably the most interesting one, I think. This is where the uses would be allowed. We, after going through this quite a bit and looking at some other factors such as our Vision 2040 and also some of our strategic plans that we're hoping to implement here, retail sales of marijuana will be limited to the highway commercial zone, which is basically the strip of commercial development south of Oak Street, and that's the basic area where this could occur. Anything involved with production, growing, processing, storage, distribution, that can only occur within the industrial lands. So we made a clear distinction that we have a zone available that folks can operate a retail business, and we have a zone available where folks can grow, process, and do whatever else they need to do to get the product to market. We have standards for these businesses. We have a restriction with their location to schools and parks. They have to be 1,000 feet from the school, which we require for medical marijuana, and also for our drug paraphernalia ordinance as well. We also require 250 feet to a park and 1,000 feet to another operation. So in other words, you're not going to see a situation where there's 1, 2, 3, 4 retail operations right next to each other. These can and must be spread out throughout the HC zone. Also, the facility must be in a permanent structure. So you're not going to have someone doing a temporary use with a little van in someone's parking lot and doing it that way. I know that was the old way of doing it, but no more. You cannot operate this. Actually, this whole thing is just open to jokes. It really is. You cannot operate this as a home occupation, although we're looking at the HC zone. There are a number of residences in there, and we do allow home occupation in the highway commercial zone. That cannot occur. And finally, you cannot have a walk-up or drive-through facility. So it's really a brick-and-mortar store at this point. We also have some operating restrictions. We have limited hours of operations. You cannot provide free samples, and product cannot be consumed on site. In fact, we already have that for medical marijuana facilities as well, so there's no real change, so to speak. We have requirements for processing. In other words, there are certain restrictions. You cannot be a processor and have retail activities at the processing site. Outdoor storage is prohibited. Odors need to be contained, and there are certain restrictions on the processing of edible products. And finally, with regard to edible products, we have similar labeling and packaging requirements that you would see for medical marijuana as well, in terms of ensuring the thing was done correctly. Basically, I said last month that, you know, in planning, when you have something like this, you usually take from someone else and kind of work it. I will be honest to say I will footnote the city of Tigard on this one, made the necessary modifications to work with the city of Lebanon's interest. With that, I will be happy to answer any questions that the council may have on this material. One other thing I would like to add, I did look at our mapping with regard to the restrictions on distance to schools, distance to parks, and separation between uses. And it's my estimation there is at least five or six sites that can readily accommodate retail operations in the highway commercial zone. And there might be more. I mean, I just took a quick cursory examination. So I want to assure you that the way this is set up, we're not doing exclusionary zoning that by our regulations effectively prohibiting the activity. We're just placing it within the highway commercial zone. And again, with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions the council may have.
Robert.
One of the things that I was concerned about, and the reason that I recommended that we postpone this issue on the recreational side until the voters could take a second look at it, was to give OLCC time to get their act together and promulgate their rules. So have you had an opportunity to review those requirements that OLCC has put together on the recreational side, and how does that impact this particular ordinance?
I really don't think it has any impact in the sense that under Section 030, they are required to simply have the appropriate permits. And so we have a land use compatibility statement that we need to sign off. And so that shows that, A, yes, the use may occur on this site, then it's up to them to show and prove to us that they've received whatever approval they need from the OLCC. So instead of getting into the weeds with them, it's like they have to show their license from the state.
And I've spent some time on that website and looked at the various forms that they have to go through, background checks, and it certainly seems to me that they're prepared and ready for the inundation of what's coming and what has come over the recent months.
Is the OLCC, did they not call out edible marijuana and have some of the, because this seems very specific and kind of different than everything else that we're talking about as far as the edible part. And I mean, I completely agree with the packaging and the section. It just seems like that would be something that OLCC would have addressed. But
it could very well be the case. We might be a little redundant here, but again, I kind of worked off another ordinance then. And also on the medical marijuana, we worked off the Ashland ordinance, and they had similar packaging requirements too. Again, one of the things I'm really after is to say medical marijuana, here's this chapter, recreational marijuana, here's this chapter, and at least this information will be right up front for them.
So it was my understanding that the county commissioners limited the production area to a very small sliver of land last year, just at the western edge of the county. Has that changed now to where production sites will now be?
Actually, that is a county level. In other words, unincorporated portions of the county. Being the jurisdiction of Lebanon here, we have some discretion where to locate production facilities. I attended a legal issues conference last December for planners, and most everyone I talked to was placing these in industrial zones. recognizing there's issues with traffic and odors and whatnot. It was also an interesting discussion with regard to the issue of odors. Some communities want to have the whole facility built and tested before they can even get started. And that gets very onerous in terms of testing. This would definitely be based on a complaint-driven situation, and we do have ordinance requirements on odors as well.
The only issue I have with this is the highway commercial zone. I think from a entrepreneurial standpoint and a freedom of business standpoint, if I want to invest in this and I want to do it, why can't I do it here versus here, if only because an ordinance says so? I guess I'd like a little discussion on the background behind that, or what are the pros and cons of having that in the downtown zone.
Actually, I think that was the core of most of our discussions at the City Hall level. The voters of Lebanon decided that retail sales of marijuana may occur along with production. So now it's really a policy decision on where those locations can occur. It's quite frankly very similar to planning. We'd like single family homes in a certain area not to be necessarily intermixed with industrial sites and waste treatment plants, because it's called Euclidean zoning. We believe that separation of types of uses has certain benefits. And with the separation of types of uses, you also get separations through the zoning process, and this is acceptable here but not acceptable there. The other thing, too, is that I think if we look at our Vision 2040, there's a great interest with the public to improving our downtown. We've made a significant investment with Strawberry Plaza as a place to bring families downtown. I'm seeing the downtown making improvements, that it's becoming a more friendly environment. I can definitely recall when I first started here years ago that I don't think a council meeting went by without some discussion about the problems of the bars downtown. Well, I haven't seen that for a couple of years now. Things have, obviously, the police department is on track with that, but also we've lost a couple, and they've been replaced with establishments that are, shall we say, family friendly. I'm not trying to advertise, but if you look at, conversion, they're there. You don't feel embarrassed bringing the wife and kids in to have a pizza and a beer. And also they're an integral part of our Strawberry Plaza development as well. So I think in that line of trying to make a family-friendly environment and bringing folks to the downtown, we saw this as probably not the best place. Whereas we wanted to be sure that if we selected another commercial zone, that commercial zone were not effectively prohibiting the sales there. And so that was probably where the distinction came in. I again, understand your comment.
Well, I just feel like this is the morality police of the city of Lebanon coming in to stand in judgment of what is and is what is not acceptable. And these are two legal businesses. If a person wants to come take an empty storefront off of Main Street and put a licensed, regulated business into it, I don't think the city should stand in their way. This is now just as legal as having a beer in Matt's restaurant. So I understand I see your viewpoint. I see the City Hall's viewpoint. But at the same time, I feel like this is prohibitive to the entrepreneurial freedom of anyone who is in Lebanon or wants to open a business here, this business there. I would like to see that go away.
I would ask... Does the Downtown Association have an official stance on that? I know we have a representative here.
Yes, yes. Monica may be able to address that when you open it up for public comments.
Okay.
Well, with the provision you're proposing, is Park Street considered a location for one?
Park, no. Downtown is, we have a separate downtown zone called the Central Business Commercial. And so any property that is zoned Central Business Commercial, retail sales would be prohibited.
So how many blocks off of Main Street is that?
It's basically a block either side. I mean, basically. You know, a little spill over here, not that far there.
And the other question I have is the distinct definition between operational and growing.
Mm-hmm. Could you elaborate on the...
Well, we have growing operations, and we have retail operations.
Mm-hmm.
Distinct, different.
Yes.
And so, obviously, the growing operations have to be somewhere other than...
That's the industrial area.
It has to be the industrial area.
Industrial, correct.
Yes.
But that also doesn't prohibit a retail sales operation from purchasing their product elsewhere, maybe grown in the county or some other county.
Other questions? Comments? Councilor Furlow is away for a moment. So
I guess what does the rest of the council think about the exclusion of the downtown corridor in this?
I am personally, I would echo your hesitancy to limit it unless a majority of the downtown businesses were just on board with that, and that is really adamantly what the businesses of Lebanon wanted. But I find it difficult to believe that that would be the case.
Well, did we not receive a letter from Mrs. I can't remember her name, but the Downtown Association? They opposed it.
From Monica? Well, we'll hear from her.
We'll hear from
her. Is Monica here?
Yes.
We can go ahead. Would the council like to have her come up and discuss? Okay.
Yes.
Go ahead, Monica, if you can come up.
Prior to my note, we have not actually officially discussed it as a landmark.
Come up to the mic. Yeah. Come up to the mic, please.
Sit down.
As far as I know, we have not officially discussed it as a Lebanon Downtown Association.
Okay. Do you know
what? We do have a meeting on the 21st. Of this month in this building that we invited all the businesses to come to, so it's something that they can discuss then also.
Okay, is there a general feeling that you're getting from the association that you've...
As far as I know, we don't discriminate against any businesses, so.
Okay. I find it difficult to believe, like Jason was saying, we have so many empty businesses down there, and I know there will be some traditional people that will just be absolutely opposed. So I understand that, and there will be some more progressive people that will be like, if it's a legitimate business, we're, like Jason said, are we the morality police? They can't smoke it there. It's simply a transaction and leaving. So
and that's already you can't smoke in a public area anyway. So, and I even oppose your thought of it. If the Downtown Association rallied up and didn't want this business, what right do they have to determine who can open a business that's legal and that's registered and that's regulated? If they suddenly become against motion pictures, then let's close down the theater because it doesn't make sense. So
yeah, that's a valid point.
Thank you, Monica. Appreciate it.
Sure, no problem.
Well, and if I've got the, I'm just guessing, but with the setbacks, it's probably one business in all of downtown anyways, with the 1,000
right.
feet all directions.
Yeah, you're not going to fit six of them down there.
Right.
No, but you'd get, with a 800-foot block, 600-foot block, you'd get...
Might get two.
A couple. You might get two, maybe.
Gary, did you have something you want to say?
For the purpose of informing this discussion, it is my understanding, and perhaps there's someone in the audience who can speak to this, but it is my understanding that there was a petition that went around downtown on this point. I don't have specific information about it, but I do believe there was some sort of instrument that was circulated. Does someone have knowledge of that? Okay.
Not at this time, no.
There will be a hearing.
Yeah. Sorry.
You'll get to talk. Anyway, that would be my only hesitation on any of this. I think we should lift that and just allow, if a business owner wants to go through the licensing process and the regulatory process, I don't see any reason that the council should stand in the way of a legitimate business in a certain area of our city. Again, the voters have spoken, and we've delayed this in order to hear the voters, hear the citizens' voice. The citizens spoke, and now I feel like we're trying to manipulate and to micromanage the voice of that by saying when and where and how. So I agree with everything else. I keep it away from schools, keep it away from other businesses. Yeah. I get it. But I don't like the limiting it in the downtown corridor.
It'd be a different story if they were able to smoke in public down there and
tonight.
Correct.
Totally different picture.
You know, at least at Matt's, I can walk out and I can drink my beer on the patio. And but you can't do that at the recreational store. So it just seems like a double standard to me. So
I gotta agree.
Yeah, I agree also.
Mm-hmm. Do we want to get a motion? Would we like to have some testimony from the audience?
I'd make a motion that we approve this amended to remove 518-040A limiting retail sales to the highway commercial zone.
Is that a motion?
Walt's still here, right?
Yeah, that was a motion.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Mayor, the public's still going to have a chance to.
Yes, sir, a second.
This is not a public hearing.
If you think you're going to need help on language.
Well, then
there's a second.
There's a public,
at the end, there's a second public session where people can speak, yes.
I would second that. Second the motion.
So basically,
making a motion to make an amendment on the motion. Amended.
I'm moving to amend this to remove 518-040A.
And I second that.
I would, could I, if you wish to go in that direction, could
That's
I make a recommendation that retail sales would be limited to the highway commercial zone and the central business commercial zone, and that covers the downtown. The mixed-use zone has a mixture of residential uses, some industrial and whatnot. I think that goes beyond the scope of what we're looking at.
Yes.
But the amendment would be to include the central business commercial.
Go. Yes.
If that's the way you wish to go.
And I wish to amend my motion to add language that states that retail sales shall be limited to highway commercial zone and the central downtown corridor to 518-040.
Is that how you worded that?
Central business commercial.
Central
Sorry,
business
commercial.
Commercial.
Oh, that's
okay.
Second.
I don't want to get in the weeds here.
I do this all the time, so no, you're fine.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to remove.
Nope.
Well, to
amend.
To amend to the central business district downtown. Is that correct, Walt?
Central business commercial.
Central business commercial district.
Commercial district downtown.
And the highway commercial zone.
We'll do a roll call vote on this.
Does it need the downtown part of it at the end?
What's that?
And central business commercial district.
Covers the downtown.
Okay, we don't need to add downtown.
No.
So just for purposes of clarity, if I could read what I believe is the amendment, the proposed amendment. It would be amending 5.18.040 sub A, retail sales shall be limited to the highway commercial zone and central business commercial district.
Correct.
Okay. Will the clerk do a roll call vote, please?
Councillor Boland?
Yes.
Councillor Elliott?
No.
Councillor Fisher?
Yes.
Councillor Furlow?
No.
Councillor Grizzle?
Yes.
Councillor Rieskamp?
Yes.
It so passes.
Okay, the motion passes 4-2. So it is including the central business downtown district.
I will have a modified ordinance available for signature tomorrow morning.
Okay.
Thank Mayor, you. Thank you.
We need to move the ordinance now.
What's that?
We need to move the ordinance as amended.
Oh, okay.
I'd now move to approve the ordinance as amended.
Because we did the amendment first.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the ordinance, and we'll do a roll call vote on the approval.
I haven't actually read it.
Oh, can you go ahead and read that, please?
I will. Ordinance Bill number 2017-2, Ordinance number 2890, a bill for an ordinance amending Title V of the Lebanon Municipal Code establishing regulations for recreational marijuana sales and production as amended.
Move for approval.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the amended resolution ordinance. All those in favor? We'll do a roll call, please.
Okay. Councillor Rieskamp?
Yes.
Councillor Grizzle?
Yes.
Councillor Furlow?
No.
Councillor Fisher?
Yes.
Councillor Elliott?
No.
And Councillor Boland?
Yes.
Okay, the ordinance passes. Next up, number 5, amendment to include e-cigarettes in the definition of smoking. Trey Kennedy.
All right, this is a nice, easy one. The chief came to me and asked me if we could add basically what's considered vaping into the no smoking provisions of our public parks. Did a little research, stole a little language, and came up with a system to do that. It may be worth the chief just giving a short summary of why he thought this was important.
Sorry about that. So, you know, it's been coming to my attention. A lot of the, we do have already a ban on smoking within our public parks. We started seeing a lot of vaping that was going on in our parks. As you all know, sometimes you can convert vaping into uses of marijuana. Marijuana can go into the vape, and therefore they're sitting there getting high. And we don't want that in our parks, in a short summary.
And in the little bit of research I did, there really is little research as to the dangers, potential dangers of secondhand vaping. So,
right.
I'm not saying they're bad. I'm not saying they're good. There's just not enough. There's not enough information at this point. So, I will read the ordinance.
Okay.
If you'd like.
Sure.
Ordinance Bill number 2017-3, Ordinance number 2891. A bill for an ordinance amending Chapter 12.12 of the Lebanon Municipal Code concerning smoking in public parks and declaring an emergency.
Move for approval.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve Ordinance Bill number 2017-3. All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? Motion passes. Ordinance passes. Number 6, Cheetah Lake Foundation proposal to transfer park ownership. Gary.
Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council, I provided to you earlier today via email, and you have hard copies in front of you, of a memorandum outlining some information about the proposal to transfer ownership of Cheetah Lake Park to the City of Lebanon. Right now, I think you're aware that the park is owned by the Cheetah Lake Foundation. It's an organization that for years has been managing and maintaining the park, and what is typical for that sort of a situation is ultimately the folks that run a private foundation like that come to the point where they don't have the wherewithal to continue to do that, and also it becomes a reality that as a private organization they don't have the same access to grant funds and that sort of, you know, big capital money to make meaningful improvements that might be necessary. Meanwhile, as they've been doing this, they've added a great asset to the community. We have many important community functions that now happen at this park, and should the foundation reach a point where they're simply going to have to walk away from it, then that asset is jeopardized. So the reality in my mind is that at some point the city's going to have to look at the idea of transferring ownership of this park to itself. The foundation has approached the city on that point, This is something that I will admit that I have delayed bringing it to you, because up until very recently, I was not able to have the information that made me feel confident that I could bring it to you and be able to answer questions, particularly around the financial aspects of the proposal, to what this would all mean. So this memo, however, provides, I think, a lot of that information, and our purpose tonight is simply to have a discussion and to get a first reading from the council. If this is something that you believe, A, we should do, and what is the timing of it? Is this something that we should be moving forward with sometime in the near future? My recommendation is that we do that. And let me walk you through the memo just briefly. But basically, the foundation has some debts against the property. And if you look at the first bullet point, it lists, we kind of detail those out. The items amount to $163,000. If we take ownership of the park, those debts will need to be cleared. We have significant funds, well more than $163,000, in our parks SDC. This is an eligible activity or use of SDC funds for the purchase and payoff, the purchase of the park, the payoff of these debts. And in fact, I'll tell you that because of the narrow scope provided in statute for the use of park SDCs, it can actually be difficult sometimes to find legitimate legal areas where we can use these funds. So they accumulate over time in our fund. This is an area where we can use those funds in a way that protects and preserves an important asset in our park system, albeit at this time it's been private. So the $163,000 to clear the debts would come from our parks SDC, and that is money that's available. Now, with transfer of the park to the city, there are significant revenues that would come to us, because we would be receiving most of the park use revenue that is now going to the private foundation. That amounts to roughly $33,000 annually. In addition to that, there are a number of grants that total about $40,000 annually that we believe most of those would be coming to us. In fact, we have leverage that the foundation does not have, in that we can use the $2.1 million value of the property as match for public grants that aren't available to the foundation. So we could potentially secure money at the state and federal level that they can't, that could move forward the improvement plans that are necessary for the park. What else can I cover here? The foundation would continue to manage the events that happen at the park. So that's not something we'd be taking on. I kind of see a time unspecified in the future where we may be asked to take over those events, but as far as transitioning, I think this is a great first step, that we would take ownership of the park, have a foundation who's well experienced at managing these events. Some of those would be like the Strawberry Fair, 4th of July event, and some of the others that we're familiar with. They have asked to keep the revenue that they receive for the Star Spangled Celebration and the Cheadle Challenge. That does not reduce the amounts of money that we've listed in here. That's already been accounted for.
What are those amounts?
For those Star Spangled? I would need to ask Jason or one of the foundation members if they could address that.
Ron, can you come up to the mic, please? Sorry.
Former mayor.
Hi, I'm Ron Passmore. I'm vice president of the Lebanon Community Foundation, ownership of the park. But as it currently sits, we realize about $10,000 in annual revenues from the 4th of July celebration, and about $6,000 from the Cheadle Challenge, and those come not from an operational standpoint, as much as the generosity of the sponsors in the community that help us put those events on.
Any other questions?
Well, and just because I'm drafting the agreement, also, as I understand it, that money, although it will go to the foundation, will be used for foundation purposes within the 501c3. In other words, going back into the park.
Correct.
Okay. So if we've answered that question, I'll go on.
Thanks, Ron.
So as we take on this additional park, there will be the need for manpower, of course, to maintain that. The bottom part of the memorandum discusses that point, that we are looking at the need to hire one more maintenance worker. 50% of that individual's time very likely would be invested in this park. We also have other parks improvements, such as Strawberry Plaza, the improvements at Christopher Columbus, and as we build the new community garden. We're taking on more properties in our park system that will need to be maintained. We project the cost of the new position all in about $75,000. Again, half of that would be credited or held against the Cheadle Lake Park. And then we see an additional $38,000 or so that we'd need to increase our operations maintenance budget for the materials and the services that we would need to bring to maintain these new parklands. Much of that new cost is covered by the, you know, if you look at your park-generated use funds, roughly $33,000, the grant funds that they're accustomed to receiving of 40, there's about $73,000, these are all rough numbers, but $73,000 to offset a lot of this expense. And I think that with the improvements that we've seen in our general fund, the fact that we've been able to reserve funds ahead of our schedule, our finances are looking solid, and I think that this is a new expense that we can handle without breaking too much of a sweat. But again, I think this is a very valuable asset to the community. It hosts several important events, and it is my recommendation that the council give us the approval to move ahead as far as finalizing a draft agreement for you to look at and maybe begin this process moving forward. There are questions.
Is the $19,000 included in the 38?
19.
Utility costs indicate, assuming the Pacific Power early first page, $19,000, and then on the second page we talk about materials and supplies at 38.8. Is that 19?
I don't believe so. Jason Williams, would you just come up here and help me with questions, please? I don't believe so. Jason, you correct me if I'm wrong.
Just a point of clarification really quick. The $16,000 Ron was talking about is not revenue that the foundation would like to keep. They are asking not to be charged lease fees for their internal events that they host now. Well, that money that is generated there from whatever mechanism that comes about is still going to be available. We just will not charge them for discussions, lease fees for their internal events.
Yeah. So, question, the $19,000 fees or charges from Pacific Power for the utilities, is that included in the $38,887?
No. No, sir, it's not.
That's included in the 163.
Yeah.
The line right below that, the 163,000.
Yeah.
Is that a remainder?
Well, but I assume that 19 is an annual cost.
No, it's a payoff.
Oh, it's a payoff.
From like moving that power pole out front, that kind of a thing?
For the power backbone, I
understand. Power backbone installation.
Yeah. Okay, so what are the utilities costs, and are those included in the 38?
Yes. Utility fees are calculated in that 38%, or that $38,000.
Any other questions?
I would love to hear the council's discussion and wisdom on how we should move forward.
I'm all for this. This is a fantastic opportunity for the city. That grant match ability, you just don't find opportunity like that to roll that over and potentially get $2.1 million to further develop that and make it more of a gem. And I'd like to point out, too, to Ron, what a tremendous job Ron and his staff have done out there. It is a gem, and I think it's going to continue to be that. It's guaranteed to be that under city control, so I'm all for it.
And that has ever been the goal of the foundation, was to eventually transfer ownership to the city. Is that not correct?
That's correct, from day one.
From day one, so... Yeah, so for 100 and what did we say?
163?
Three.
Yeah. That's a flipping bargain, especially considering what all they've done out there. So I think it's a great day for the city.
Yeah, I think it's something that we should do. What about taxes, though? Are they paying taxes on that property now, and would we be paying the taxes on it?
No, there's no taxes.
No taxes.
501(c)(3).
Oh, that, okay.
The nonprofit.
Yeah.
And of course, the city wouldn't pay taxes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
This addresses several areas of our strategic plan, opens the door for a venue where tremendously more cultural activities can occur during the summer months. The city will benefit largely from this for decades and decades to come.
And you say that the $163,000 is available from the SDCs?
That's correct.
Looks like a no-brainer to me.
I agree.
Okay, I think I'm hearing unanimous consent that we should go ahead with the process.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll work that internally and with the foundation, and we'll bring back an agreement to you in the near future. Thank you.
Okay. Before we go on to the last thing and then public comments, is there going to be anyone that's going to want to speak, the public? I just want to see if there's I thought there would be. We're going to take a five-minute recess, and then we'll come back, and then we'll do that and the last couple items that we have. Meeting to order. Okay, up next is City Manager's Report, Gary Marks.
Mayor Aziz, members of the City Council, two items, my report's in the packet, but there's two items that are not in the packet that I want to discuss with you. Earlier today, I emailed you some information about our upcoming goal-setting session on February 22nd. There's a hard copy of that memorandum in front of you. What this is it's a questionnaire that I'm asking each of you as council members to fill out in preparation for our goal-setting session. I'm asking you to provide your top five short-term and top five long-term goals for the city. I'm asking you to put those in a rank priority for the purpose of allowing me to do an intensity scoring on the items that you list, along with your fellow council members. What I've done in the past and what I've found to be true in this process is that there's always commonality to some extent in the goals that the council has. Doing an intensity analysis of your ranked priorities helps focus the council's ultimate goal setting session. So I'll ask you to indulge me in this exercise. And online, or when you go into your email, this is a fillable form, so you can do it right on your computer screen. And I'm asking if you can get that back to me by the next regular council meeting on February 8th. And I can process this information, and ahead of the goal setting session, I will, in that meeting packet, provide you with the results of this exercise. And in addition, I'm asking the department directors, for your benefit, to share their ideas about potential goals so you can see where your management staff is headed and what their thought processes are. So I'm hoping to bring to you a session for setting goals that has a wealth of information in it and will help you in a very efficient way come to some decisions together about goals for our community. So if there are any questions about that, I'd be happy to address those.
When will we be able to see the department input?
It'll be in the information that we send out in the meeting packet. There will be the information from this questionnaire. There will also be a matrix provided to you that shows the 41 action items in the strategic plan where the city is the lead partner. I have been working with the appropriate department heads for each subset of those action items so that I can provide you a matrix showing our recommendations as a management team on implementation of each of those 41 items over the next 5 years. So you'll have that in front of you during the goal setting session. So actually at the goal setting session, there'll be two things I'll be asking you to do is to look at the matrix that I provide you coming from the strategic plan and make any adjustments to that that you think are appropriate, and then to adopt that, but then also to establish your own goals, which may or may not include some of those items in the that appear in the strategic plan. The council goal setting session could very well, and I would expect would include items that don't appear in the strategic plan at this time. So I hope that provides the information you were looking for. Are there any other questions? Okay. The next item I want to share with you, I've provided for you a letter from our library director, Carol Dinges. Carol has informed me that she intends to retire June 30th of this year. And so on this occasion, I want to recognize Carol. There's an argument to be made that I'm sitting here as your city manager today because of libraries. That's where my career in public service began, so I have a heart for it. I've worked with many people in the library service, and I can tell you easily that I've not met another person who's been involved with bringing library service to communities that has a bigger heart for her job. And I've always respected that about Carol and appreciate it greatly. She's also been easy to work with and always eager to work with me to address the issues at the library to make sure that we're moving ahead in positive directions. I'm sure many of you will agree that both Carol and her husband, John, the level of involvement they have in the community is something I think special. Wherever I go around town, Carol and John are being involved and working to make our community better. And in the process, Carol has represented our library to the outer community, I think, in an outstanding way. So I want to honor Carol at this time for her service to our community, but then also make you aware that with her retirement, that we will very soon begin a recruitment process for a new library director. I've known about her impending retirement for a time, and because of that, I've made some initial preparations for the recruitment effort. We're going to begin with the library staff themselves updating the job description for the position of library director. We're going to put together a process that includes the library staff, includes the city council, city staff generally, and also will provide an opportunity at a meet and greet for the public to come in and meet the finalist candidates. So I could talk more about this, but be aware that the process that's coming to find a new library director is going to be one that will be inclusive and take in a lot of viewpoints from a lot of folks. So with that, again, I commend Carol for her service and would ask you after the meeting perhaps or sometime in the near future if you would also make your good thoughts known to Carol. So with that, if there are any questions, I'll be happy to respond to those. Thank you.
did you want to go over your city report, your manager's report?
He did. Well, kind of.
What's that?
Yeah, I did mention that that was in packet. I could.
Did you not? I no, I just. Sure, I didn't know if you wanted to highlight anything.
Could sure cover some of those.
I mean, I went through.
I'll cover the Lebanon Arts Commission. As the council is well aware, you created a commission in November. We went out for the month of December seeking applicants to populate the new commission. We received just enough applicants to populate the commission, but we were in an imbalance between visual and performing arts. And I felt it was important that we have a balance of those interests in the arts, so we have a well-rounded group of folks to deal with both ends of the art world. So we have extended our application period into January, and beginning in early February, we'll begin the process of identifying some recommendations for appointment to that new commission. Also, I can report that since we had the summit on homelessness at the Boulder Falls Center at the end of October, that Dave Albanese, our community service officer, has done a great job in pulling together the new coalition. They're functioning very well together. I understand meeting weekly and preparing for the work of working individually with members of our homeless community to try to address the issues that perpetuate their living on the streets, to try to help those folks who are ready to come off the streets and get help for the issues that they might have. So I'm encouraged by the work that has been done now, and I am optimistic that we're going to have some good results come from that effort. Other than that, if there are some other items on my city manager report that you would be interested in discussing, I would be happy to do so.
Any questions? Okay. Moving on, items from council. And one quick thing, I would like to thank Bob Elliott, councilor and council president, for taking the reins for the last 3 months as I've been going through the cancer treatment that I've been going through. I appreciate everybody's patience, and I'm on the mend, and it's slow, but I'm still doing good, and I appreciate your putting up with my voice coming and going at times, so thank you for that. Time for public comments, and this is an opportunity for the community to come up. And I don't know if we have anybody signed up or?
No additionals.
Okay. When you do come up, and I'll call you individually, come up and sign in. You'll have 5 minutes, and the timer will turn yellow when you have 30 seconds left. And I will cut you off because I don't know how many people are going to want to talk at 5 minutes. And then the city, the council will have 2 minutes to respond if we choose to do so. So who would like to speak? Come on up forward. And if you'll state your name and address and write it on the form there.
Thomas Pouliot, and I'm here to, I live at 1350 Williams, and I have here a copy of the Oregon State Law on marijuana, which I will leave with the council. It came to my attention that there's a gentleman here in Lebanon who has a heart monitor. He uses the medical marijuana to slow down the process of the heart monitor. It's a medical issue. That's what he does. I don't know how that's going to affect, how shall I say, his ability to perform, because he has a business. that, you know, if a doctor implants that pacemaker, then the doctor does not know that he's using the medical marijuana to slow that down. Or if that becomes some type of an issue medically, or I guess that's how I want to put it. But, anyway, I'll go ahead with this. It says that 1 ounce of extracted oil from marijuana. Note that the oil must be purchased from someone with a license to extract that oil. Does the city have anything in process to license somebody who extracts the oil, or how would you pursue that if you have a distributor or?
That would be an OLCC thing. I don't think that would have it. That wouldn't have anything to do with the city. That would be an OLCC thing.
Okay.
The Oregon Liquor Commission. That's who regulates that.
Appreciate that. That says here that as of August 1st, 2015, most of the laws contained with ballot measure 91, the law allowing adult sales at medical marijuana dispensaries. Are we getting some dispensaries here in Lebanon?
We don't know. We assume so after passing the law, yes.
Anyway, I'll leave this with you.
Okay.
And also, I will leave something else here that I have here. This book contains some information about marijuana and trips. It has to do with cities like Seattle and some of the bigger cities and how many they have. Like, I think Seattle had like 121 dispensaries. And so I'll leave this book with you so that you can look it over and make some kind of a decision in marijuana.
Okay.
But I thank you very much.
Thank you for your time.
You can keep that. Because it has a lot of information there that you may want to look over to take time to do that.
Thank you, Tom. Next, would someone else like to come up and address council?
My name is Larry Shuttlesworth, and I have a business in Lebanon. You mentioned the petition earlier, and I'm the one that started the petition on Main Street. And so we do have it, but I don't have it with me tonight. But I would like to find out who I'm to give that to. Now, these are all the store owners down on Main Street that signed the petition that would like to try to keep the marijuana out of the stores downtown. So who would I give it to?
You can give it to Linda.
Okay. I don't have it tonight, but I will get it to you.
Okay. That's all. Is that it? All right. Thank you, Larry. Okay, next.
My name is Jeannie Callahan. I sent a letter to all the council members earlier this week indicating that I was in support of the ordinances written by Walt Wendelowski. I just wanted to voice my disappointment in the council in voting to change the ordinance to allow recreational marijuana facilities and dispensaries on Main Street. I'm an active member of the Lebanon Downtown United Group, which is an association within the Lebanon Downtown Association. It's a subset, and we represent the merchants and property owners. And I can tell you over the last several weeks, I've had multiple business owners and property owners tell me that they did not want to see recreational dispensaries on Main Street. One of the concerns that we have is merchants. So I own property at 865 South Main. I own the property, and my husband and I also own the business that's occupying that property. We actually own one of the few properties on Main Street that has private parking facility. We have approximately 10 spaces. We spend quite a bit of time already trying to enforce parking at that location for our privately owned business. There's quite a few people who try and take advantage of that parking to do other shopping on Main Street, and that prevents people from coming to our business who want to. And I can envision if you're going to allow recreational marijuana dispensaries on Main Street, there's going to be additional parking constraints. In my experience, I used to own a liquor store in Colorado. It's a very transactional basis type business. I would guess that recreational marijuana has a similar profile, and that people who come to make purchases there are just coming in to make that purchase and leave. It creates a lot of congestion. So I'm asking the council to reevaluate their decision about allowing that type of dispensary on the Main Street corridor, where we're already experiencing quite a bit of parking pressure. So if there's an opportunity to change that ordinance, perhaps in, I don't know if there's an opportunity this evening or what that process might be, but I'd like to understand what steps might be taken.
Well, it's been voted, so it's actually going to be an ordinance now. If there would be any change, it would have to be brought up by council.
Okay. So how would I bring that up with council at another
talking
meeting?
To the councilors, your representatives from your district, the mayor, myself, and you know, other than your letter, I had seen nothing else from anybody else from downtown or heard anything, and we didn't see a petition. We just asked the director, we gave her an opportunity, and she didn't have any particular bent on the situation. So really, I had heard nothing.
Yeah, we were supposed to have a meeting last night, and it got canceled. So.
Okay. Well, I mean, just from the council standpoint, that's we can only go on when people contact us.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, is there someone else?
Council, my name is Chris Kopp. I'm the husband. My wife and I own the property, 865 South Main Street, and we operate a business out of there. I'm disappointed as well. I don't want to go so far as saying the council is naive about things, because I'm sure you all think about things. But there are some issues. I know that it's the people that are against having the dispensaries downtown. I know it's our responsibility. We should have turned in a petition, et cetera. I get that. My concern is that no matter what's said now, because you all have voted on it, that it's done. You know, I own a business downtown. I'm pretty sure none of you do. You know, the chief, you're down there a lot. I get that. There's a lot of issues with parking, which I'm sure everyone knows. But our parking lot, as my wife said, all day long trying to keep people from parking there. So now that this transactional business is going to come in, where is that overflow in parking going to be? Cars in and out, more traffic is going to come down.
And so can I clarify that parking?
Sure.
Because you both mentioned that. So if this were another kind of business that were going to fill a storefront downtown, but that was transactional and cause more, because we have a lot of empty. So if it was a different kind of business, would you still have this issue? Is it about putting a transactional, or is it about the fact that it is a marijuana?
Two-sided question for me. I'm, you know, for the record, I'm, you know, marijuana, it's here, it's legal. The state, city, whatever is spoken, I have no problem with that. I would prefer it not be downtown. You know, everybody talks about trying to make downtown as the core, and, you know, if you turn around and look at that sign, it says something about family and community and so forth. You should probably think about that. You know, a liquor store, would you like to have a liquor store downtown? You know, Mr. Boland said that we can't tell people what we want to have downtown. Really? Just think about that. Think about what you know, you just said, so you can't tell me what I can open up downtown. I got a big building. So, and I'm not saying that as antagonistic. I'm just saying that, you know, I think that we can, as citizens, choose what businesses and how we want things to go down. Going back to your statement or question, transactional business, and that's what the marijuana is, it's, I think it's going to add a lot of cars. It's, marijuana's popular. So I think it's going to add a lot of cars. Cars coming in and out, parking, leaving, more pedestrians. Yeah, it's going to be good for some businesses. I don't think it's going to be good for others.
So pretty much any of that kind of business you would be against.
Transactional business like that in that vein, I think you should look at that. You're trying to draw people downtown. I seriously don't think that someone's going to come downtown, buy their marijuana, and then go shopping downtown. I just don't think that. From my experience coming from Colorado, it's not how it works. It does not work like that. You know, the jokes are being made that, you know, Sugar Vibes is going to have a great business. Well, maybe, but I don't think that's the way it's going to work. I just would urge the council to rethink how they want to go about where they want to go about putting allowing businesses, allowing that type of a business downtown. I strongly disagree with it.
Would you classify Sugar Vibes as a transactional business?
I walk to work every morning and walk home every night, so I've got a pretty good feel of what goes on. For the most part, you know, it seems to me that people buy a donut and they sit down.
Really?
That's what I see when I walk to work. I'm not saying that obviously people buy dozens of donuts and show up at the fire station or wherever it is they show up. But,
point it to me. I saw that.
I changed it as I moved around. I know the implications. So, I think it could be, but I see people sitting down a lot. I'm not trying to attack anybody's business. I get it. It's America, and we want to be able to. Everyone wants to have the freedom to open up the business that they choose, but I think it's the wrong idea that if the property owners and business owners, a majority, do not want marijuana dispensaries on Old Town Main Street, I think that that is a voice that should be heard.
There's one key issue with that, and that is that you can be upset with us. At the same time, we'll be disappointed in you. I'm disappointed right now that this didn't come to me before the meeting, because had it come to me, it may have changed my stance. I could open a candy shop, and that's a transactional business.
Right.
And I would almost guarantee that if a saltwater taffy shop was going in some location downtown, you wouldn't be here protesting it or upset about it. I visit downtown quite often, and my work brings me downtown quite often in a regular vehicle now. I have never, in the 22 years I've lived here, 23 years I've lived here, I've never had to walk more than a block to get to wherever I was going downtown. There may not be a parking spot directly in front of the store I want to get to, but I either get it on the next block or I turn the corner, I park right there on one of the side streets, and I walk to my business. So the parking issue, I can understand your issue with people parking in your lot, and that's a private lot, and I get that. But I don't think public parking is as inaccessible as it's trying to be made here right now.
So let me clarify something. I'm not saying that parking is an issue as in there's no place to park. I'm not, you know, every day you hear people complain about parking, but that when they go to a certain big box store that's at the other end of town, they're willing to walk all the way across the parking lot, but they won't walk a block when they're downtown. They say there's no parking. So I'm not saying that that's, I'm saying that the influx of traffic that it's going to cause, because it's popular. There's a lot of people that are going to buy it. You know,
mm-hmm. And a lot of people go to Sugar Vibes.
Absolutely. And Sugar Vibes is going to be, is open from 6 in the morning until 1 in the afternoon. It's not open at, it's not open the rest of the time. My concern is the influx of traffic that's coming and going, and then you're not going to have the people that want to come down and shop they're going to have to park farther. And I'm worried that the people are going to stop coming downtown because of that.
Okay, your time is up.
I'm trying to answer.
I think you have valid points, and I appreciate you. I appreciate you coming and talking. And I may not agree with you, but I appreciate you coming and talking to us. And I wish, and I would encourage you guys that have concerns to come talk to us prior to the meeting and prior to the vote. All of our email, all of our phone numbers, my home address is online. I have people knock on my door. I have people call me. And if I had seen a petition with all but two businesses from downtown on it, that's a concern.
If I can just say, add one thing, Mayor. A number of us thought that you were going to talk about it. We were going to get a chance to come up here and talk. And a number of us came, and we thought we were going to be able to talk beforehand, and that's not what happened. So,
I understand that.
Our bad. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Chris. Is there anyone else that would like to speak? What's that?
Yeah, you can come up.
Come on up. Somebody else, but I'll sign up first. Okay.
You just sit down and talk.
Go ahead and sit down.
I didn't know I was supposed to sign somewhere. Okay. Okay. Hi, I'm Mary Kerr, and I'm sorry I'm discombobulated tonight. Okay. I will talk about the marijuana thing because my concern, Wayne answered one of my questions, is we've seen in the paper in other communities of Girl Scouts selling cookies in front of marijuana shops now. And I was concerned about, do we have a kind of a permit that says children or other organizations don't sit in front of, you know, I don't want to see a picture in the Albany paper where our Girl Scouts are selling cookies in front of a marijuana shop. I really don't think that that's quite appropriate. But Wayne said, no, they would have to have permission from the business owner. As a shopper and resident of Lebanon for 43 years, I'm a transactional customer, okay? I go down, I want to go to Mr. Nemo's place. I want to go to the bookstore. I want to go to the secondhand places. I go down for one errand. I shoot out. I can always find parking. Sometimes I may not find it in front of the store, but I can get it across the street and then kind of jaywalk, Mr. Okay, anyway. So, as a person, we have a couple of taverns downtown. But that doesn't mean that this business has to be on downtown. Maybe there's a side street that they can rent. I don't know. I really don't know. And I understand people's fears, but it is legal now. And it is a tax revenue. And we are learning how much taxes we're going to be getting from this revenue. And I think our police will have a better handle with a visual place on who might be doing things other than what they should be doing, rather than if it's out somewhere in the country. I think that there's some validity of having thing places in sight. Anyway, thank you very much. You voted on my property earlier today. I appreciate it. You're doing a good job. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Mary.
She brings up a good point, which is that for all the reasons that we're arguing against the business being there, the difficulty parking, the transactional, it's hard to find a spot, that would be every reason to discourage someone from opening a spot downtown, and they would push them to the highway commercial zone, wouldn't it?
That's what an entrepreneur evaluates every time they open a business, but that's up to the business owner, not up to us.
If those individuals that are going to be shopping at, say there's a storefront downtown and there's two others that are more easily accessed, they're not going to go downtown.
Exactly.
Welcome to the world of business,
it.
Yeah.
Hey, Matt.
I'm Matt Cowart. I'm half owner of Conversion Brewing Company. Most of you guys know me pretty well. There's been a lot of talk about this. I'm a very busy person, and I would have contacted you all personally about my concerns beforehand if I would have known before this evening that this was happening. There's a lot of different ways you can go about this. Unfortunately, when you're talking about something like this that is kind of controversial, it is mostly, I feel, emotional and moral things that people bring up. I have my own emotional and moral concerns about this, but I do not feel that those are valid arguing points, and so I'm not going to be talking about those. One of the things that I'm concerned about for downtown, the downtown core, is parking, obviously. Every business that comes in is going to take up parking space, and that's just the reality. Part of the job of the city, any city, is regulating the zoning for businesses, and I do agree with Councilman Bullen that maybe the city shouldn't regulate where this can go, where that can go, but the reality is there's certain places that fit businesses better than others. And this is new for all of us, I think. So there's a lot of unknowns. One of the issues that I have, and I think a lot of other people have, is you can go down to Sugar Vibes and buy a dozen donuts and then sit on the park bench and eat that donut. But it is not legal to smoke marijuana on that park bench. Now, just because you put it someplace else doesn't mean they're not going to try to do it there. But my biggest concern is the business owners downtown have been trying to promote a family-friendly atmosphere, and I think all of you agree probably smoking marijuana is not a family activity, but it's not going to occur down there, or shouldn't, hopefully. But it is a 21 and over business, and as far as I understand at this point, OLCC requires you to black out all windows in it, so it is going to be, whether it's a shady business or not, they kind of do look shady. There's ways to get around that. I mean, you can put like a little foyer in the front that looks all cutesy and fun, but the area that you go to purchase marijuana has to be completely visually impaired from outside. And it's like, I believe it's still like that with drug paraphernalia, I'm not really sure, but it's just not, when you're walking downtown with your kids and you see the big marijuana leaf, that sign outside, I mean, I don't, you know, all signs have to be approved by the city, so that may not be exactly what happens, but it's not something I would want to explain to my six-year-old as I'm walking downtown in a supposedly being pushed for a family-friendly area. I will agree, selling marijuana on Main Street is definitely going to bring customers down there, and my business may benefit from that, and it may not. I really don't know, and we may not have problems with somebody smoking on there, but I do feel for you guys because it's your job now to regulate that and decide maybe this isn't the place we really want this. You know, I know that it's passed now. It can be voted on to amend that, but I would strongly encourage at least Main Street to be no marijuana sales on Main Street. You know, when you're trying to promote a specific look to a downtown, most people don't, when you say, hey, what do you want on downtown? Most people aren't going to say, oh, in a stripper bar or, you know, someplace that sells a highly regulated thing. I personally sell a regulated product, alcohol. We manufacture it and sell it there. The other thing I wanted to say real quick that somebody might want to check on, I didn't get a chance to read the bill, but it looks like the separation of production, growing, and manufacturing is completely separate from sales. One of my concerns is if you want a good growing business, you have to allow them to do certain things. If I would like to see that you could put a bakery together with the retail sales of a product, most zoning for downtown does allow you to, like, so if I want to do a brewery that didn't have retail sales up front, I would not have been allowed to do it in the downtown core. That's not allowed in zoning, okay? It's only allowed because we're a brew pub. So if you want viable businesses, I probably would look at changing that so that they can take oil and use it. I don't know. I don't even know how they do it, but make an added value product on site and sell it there. So, and I don't know how you would do that. I like I said, I haven't read it, so I don't know. But that's something I would maybe look at.
I don't know if legally they can do that, but I don't think they can produce and sell at the same location by state law.
Right.
By state law. Okay. Yeah. Well, that's probably not a real wise decision by state, but
not the first.
Yeah. No. Nope. It's not. All right. Thank you, guys.
Time's up. Thanks, Matt.
Thanks, Matt.
Okay. Next.
part. It has nothing to do with this. But it happened about 50 years ago when I was living in Central Oregon. And there was this place of business that people drove by, and there might be two rigs in front of it during the week. On the weekend, there might be four or five. And the do-gooders and excess found out what it was, and it was an adult bookstore. It was the best advertisement that gentleman ever had. And it lasted for 5-6 months till the noonless wore off, and it was over with. And that may be what happens to this. If it goes downtown or wherever, when the noonness wears off, there's not going to be anything there. That's all I had to say.
Thank you, Bill.
Could be right.
Okay, next.
My name is Sven Robertson. I've recently moved to Lebanon, and I'm also in the process of opening a recreational marijuana store. So I guess I'll play the role of pariah here to a certain degree.
Is your microphone?
I've heard a lot of
your microphone on.
Is that working now?
There.
Yes.
There you go.
Sorry about that. I'm like I said, I'm nervous. I'm not much of a public speaker. A lot of the information that has been presented here kind of strikes me as contradictory to a certain degree. I think the point has been made that marijuana stores, a transactional company, may increase congestion. And to me, it would seem that congestion does translate to traffic count. Traffic count should increase awareness of what businesses are open and operating in this downtown business district. I'd like to tell you guys that my family and I are in this industry. We've been in this industry for about 3 years now, which obviously makes us new, but the industry itself is new. Between Tacoma, Washington and Eugene, Oregon, we have three stores. Myself and my wife have located here to Lebanon. We also own a producer-processor company in outside of Seattle as well. So while I can't point to any type of formal information or data, because I don't think there is formal information or data on this industry where it pertains to how retail sales affect communities and how this transactional type of customer interacts with traditional customers, I think that at the base of this problem is that moral question. And it was a question that I myself struggled with. I am a family man. I have children, and it was a difficult obstacle to get around for me. But that moral question seems to be, we don't want those people in and around our store or our business or our homes or whatever that may be. And I'd like to try to put a face to those people from what I've seen in our stores. A lot of people think, okay, you're going to have these drug addicts come in and buy $5 worth of marijuana and sit out front and smoke the product. And that simply has not been the case in our locations. And I know that that is completely against the law, as well as OLCC regulations. Our actual average transactional sales is about $61. Our average age of customer, the only data that we actually collect, is 34 years old. We don't have any other data than that, because simply to collect more than that would be an invasion of privacy. We have never once had a fight break out in any of our establishments, nor have we actually had a heated argument. The perception of, well, it's a family-oriented part of town where you can come and eat and drink beer, I understand that, but to me, this product isn't something that's consumed out in the public. It's not something that you should smoke on a park bench, just as I'm sure a bottle of vodka shouldn't be drank on that same park bench. regardless of the law, I understand people are going to do that, which I think brings up another topic in that our biggest competition is drug dealers. We provide a legal avenue for people to purchase the product that are already using the product. We do so in a manner according to OLCC regulations, and there have been a lot of these regulations brought up, and we adhere to those. The first step in opening a store is to go to the city and request what's called a LUX form, this land use compatibility statement. We obtained that form from the city of Lebanon, signed by Mr. Waldenowski, I believe his name is.
None of us can say
close
it.
Close enough.
Okay. Sorry. On November 28th. And with that, we proceeded with our process of moving forward with our store. So I guess the point I'm trying to make is I think that there is a lot of supposition about the type of clientele that we will attract and the negative aspects that we will bring to the community. And I believe that judging by, we do have one store that is in a very similar location in Tacoma, Washington, that I'm not, no offense, but suffered a slight level of blight. There were vacant buildings in the area. With the level of security that has to be installed in these stores, similar to the OLCC requirements, there are so many cameras that people tend to stray away from doing something that they're going to be seen doing, whether it's outside the store, behind the store, or in the store.
Your time is up. Can you wrap it up?
I just wanted to give a face and a voice to the opposition of this and let you know that we will do everything that we can to bring a positive aspect to the community without bringing big dope signs and marijuana leaves and that kind of nature. We are in it as a business.
I have a question.
Okay.
As a potential business owner downtown, what do you do, or what have you done in your other stores or with your other businesses? Sorry. What have you done to enhance the community or support the community? Do you make a practice, and you don't have to answer, but do you make a practice of sponsoring
Absolutely.
Youth teams or donate, you know, give me a little glimpse as to what you're going to bring besides a retail establishment to this downtown core?
There have been three different cancer awareness functions that I should say that my brother, who owns a store, as well as my father, who owns a store in Eugene, both have cancer. So we participate in a lot of the cancer awareness, the breast cancer awareness functions. Community involvement is very important. If you can understand our point of view from being the pariah, we have to do as much as we can and work a little bit harder to join these communities and not be ostracized. So we plan to do the same in Lebanon. We're not here to simply open up a store, stick a manager in this store, and walk away in 3-4 months. This process is going to take us years because it's not a donut shop. It's something that will take involvement within the community to gain recognition and to gain acceptance, even though it's legal, great, but it's still not morally accepted by a lot of people.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to speak to council?
Did you want my home address or business address?
Okay, seeing no one else, is there any items from the press?
Okay.
Okay, a few things on housekeeping here. Scheduled meetings. We have Friday, February 8th is going to be at 5 p.m. They're going to reschedule the work session. So our next regular session at 5 p.m. instead of 6, the work session, we'll have dinner there, I'm assuming.
What day?
Okay. And that is February 8th.
Wednesday.
At 5 p.m.
Okay.
Right before the regular.
And then February 22nd at noon, City Council goal setting session. Arrive at 11:30 for lunch and photos. Get our council photos taken, so look nice.
11:30
on February 22nd. March 8th, 6 p.m., regular session. And then March 22nd, we need to know if everybody's available for a noon session regarding water treatment plant construction contract. That's March 22nd at noon.
I'm good.
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe.
Bob, you okay? Okay. Maybe on you?
Maybe gone.
Rebecca?
I'll be in Hawaii. Oh, I'm just kidding. I'm good.
You're always in Hawaii.
I'm just kidding.
Okay. I get it all? Very good. With that, we're going to adjourn the meeting. Thank you, everybody.